I'm Aaron Plessinger, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Levi Kitchen, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Malcolm Stewart, and I choose OGIO.
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 Welcome to the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Today is part two with the bad boy himself, Ricky Johnson, Mr. Seven Time. So we left off talking about some stuff, but the last show, you talked about the Motocross of Nations and Trophy of Nations, right? Mm-hmm. So now we call
so
it the
So should
Motocross.
I get an extra credit for that? So that means I actually won five instead of four?
You should. I think so. But
I need to change the record books.
Yeah. But these days, people call it the Motocross of Nations, and it's just this one-day event. But for young guys like Chase here, explain how it used to work. It was two different races in two different countries usually, right?
Yes, we had four guys, and everybody was on 500s the first week. Mm-hmm. I can't remember which one was Trophy and which one was Motocross.
Trophy was 500s.
Right, so the first week was that I did it was in Finland. And went there, and the first moto... I'm in third coming around and bike seizes. So done. Mm-hmm. So I spectated the whole time. David cased and tore up his ankles, it really sore. I told everybody, I'll start in the back row because I'm strong because it's 45 minute motos and the bumps were monsters. Like it was
45 minute motos on a 500.
Right. But it was like Southwick. You know, I was like, go out there and see it's all graded. You're like, oh, this isn't going to get that rough. And Roger's like, you'll see. And the fall, dude, the whoops are huge. So I said, I'll start in the back and I can charge forward, you know, and you guys got, because you got more time on the track, you guys go. And next thing you know, we go on the first turn. David falls, Johnny falls, and I fall. I'm like, holy shit. So I get up, get going. It's raining. We're going. David was struggling. Johnny had a little bit of problems. And I worked my way back up to seventh. And from being down on the first turn, so which was good. And that was the point that they used my one moto to get you seventh to win that. Then we got on a ferry that we spent during the next week and we went to Sweden. And then completely different track, hard pack through the trees and all the different stuff. Completely, really, really, really fast. And everybody's 250s. On 250s, yeah. And so then we had to switch from riding 500 one weekend to running 250 the next. So they had the same problem. Something about our Yamahas didn't jive. Mm-hmm. In practice, I seized my bike. I got a stock cylinder from one of the importers, threw it on there. So it was down a little bit, and I didn't do great there either. Jeff Ward had the race of his lifetime. I mean, if you want to look up perfection, like what Jet is doing every now and then, Jeff Ward had it that there. I mean, he was just so fast and just obliterated everybody, smoked everybody. And we won that again. And so quite an honor to be part of that team because I was a 250 championship, Wardy was 125 championship, Osho was Supercross champion, and David was 500. So pretty cool cast of characters.
So was it four riders per country?
Four riders per country, yeah.
Oh, wow. So it was way different back then.
Right. Well, and then I left that out, and I apologize for this, Brock. As Brock was there racing, you know, we talked about him racing in the Supercross, and Dave is like, my ankle, I can't ride. And so Brock came in, and Cliff White worked on his bike, and Brock came in and was the backup and rode really, really strong. Brock was always fast. Yeah. So he was the one that helped us win that 250 championship.
Through your career, who was your closest friend of like all those heroes?
Brock. Brock for a lot of reasons. One, Brock was my mentor. So I've known Brock since I was... 10. He was 13 or 14. He went to junior high with my sister, who was 4 years older than me. We were down at a place called Speedway 117 or South Bay Speedway down in Otay, down by Mexico, obviously in the San Diego, Chula Vista side. And he was riding a Kawasaki Green Streak, and I was riding XR75s. And then my dad was always starting shit with other people and this and that. And so he didn't like the arrogance of the LA guys, Orange County guys, the Jeff Ward, Brad DeToy, Rod, Brian Meyer, Scoff, and all of their stuff. And he said, we have some guys down here that'll whip your ass. And he met Ron Turner and Brock Glover. So we took my sister's GT100, cut the frame, put small wheels on it, took it up to Donnie Emler. He built a custom pipe for it, for Brock to go chase these guys down. Uh-huh. And that was, so my dad, besides Brock's dad, was Brock's first sponsor. And so during that time, Brock was older. He was racing, riding for DG, and then he got his Yamaha ride. And I remember he was 16 when he got his Yamaha mm-hmm. ride. People don't realize that, or 16 or 17 when he won the championship. And he had the bitchin' van. He had all the cool stuff, his own stickers, and he would drag me along riding with him all the time. He would, you know, I was on an 80. I was 11 and 12. And then when he was at Yamaha, we're going to race at Carlsbad, and I said, Brock, let me ride your bike during the week. And I was little, I was only 12, mm-hmm. but I loved it. My wheels didn't fall on the bumps, and I had a good time. And so I said, hey, can I race it this week? And he goes, yeah, just don't tell anybody. Shh. and so I go out there and I race the junior class, and I'm like, I had so much fun. But my dad's like, well, you can't have both. We can't afford it. So we sold. I said, I want to go 125. So we got 125s. I gave Brock his bike back. My dad bought a bike at Lucky Yamaha. Marty Coyne was 20 years old, was the sales manager who owns Coyne Motorsports. Mm-hmm. And Gary Johnson, Jimmy Johnson's dad, was the mechanic in the back, and he was my mechanic. Mm-hmm. And so I started racing that, and in 3 months turned pro and just kept charging. That's when I, you know, met your brother. Didn't meet you at the time. You were too little. and Saddleback, Carlsbad, Escape Country, Dunes, just SoCal market.
Yeah. Okay, I just got this idea. We talked about Brock.
Yep.
I'll just name off some of the icons that you came up with, and you could tell me a story about each one.
So Bob Hanna, we still, it's kind of like a Seinfeld Newman thing with the two of us. I don't know. It's just some things don't just go away. Bob Hanna raced Anaheim, first Supercross. I was 16 years old. Actually, second one. I did the one, they had one in the fall of 1980 and 81. I qualified, as I said, I was 16. In the main event, I think I'm third or fourth, and Bob's making his big comeback, number 100, and he comes to get by me, and I'm riding over my head because the crowd's cheering, and I'm holding my breath and having a great time, tough time, and so I'm over riding the entries. It was kind of muddy and this and that. Well, Bob thinks I'm brake checking him and cutting him off. I'm just trying to survive. He comes by me on the outside, and he kicks me, and he flips me off. And I'm like, fuck this guy. So we come into the corner. I let off a little bit, and then I just pin it, and I just tried to take him out. And I hit him really hard, and he went off the track. And then I'm like, oh, shit, I got to go because, you know, he's the hurricane. He's going to tear me up. So I'm going, and I overjump something. I land in the mud, and I kind of case it, and he goes by and this and that. And so everyone's – I thought we were going to fist fight after the race because when someone kicks your front fender and flips you off, that's fighting, we're gonna fight. And anyways, nothing happened. And so we go up to Seattle the next week, and my mechanic, Ray Hunold, goes, you need to say something. And of course, being a coward, like, no, man, I'll settle it on the track. He's like, no, you need to go say something to him. You need to just literally show him that you're not intimidated by him. And man, it was the scariest thing, one of the scariest things I've ever done. So I see him over there, and I'm, okay, practice what I'm gonna say. What are you gonna say? What are you gonna say? So I go up, and I'm standing there, and he looks at me, and he doesn't know who I am, you know. I go, hey, Bob, I'm Ricky Johnson. I'm the guy you flipped off last weekend. And it didn't crush him, but he's like, you know, now he doesn't have, you don't have the adrenaline from racing moto. You don't have your helmet on. You're exposed.
Yeah.
And I didn't do that like, okay, now let's fist fight. It was like, hey, this is who I am, and that. And we had quite a tumultuous relationship after that when he went to Honda. Mm-hmm. It got even worse. But I modeled my career after him and so many others. Brock mainly, mm-hmm. but Bob Hanna was the guy. He was the one that took down Marty Smith and Brock and everybody. So I'm like, I got to be an asshole and arrogant like him. At one point I ran a duck bill because I thought I want to be more like this guy.
Yeah.
But then I realized, there's only one Bob Hanna, and I just need to be the first Ricky Johnson.
Mm-hmm. Okay, how about David Bailey?
David Bailey. Ran into Bailey the first time not physically, we're in Waco, Texas in 1981. And he's running 250. He's on the Kawasaki. They had a big box van with Fox on, and his dad, Gary, was driving. And my dad was just driving a regular van. I was just a production Yamaha guy, privateer. And so all of a sudden, we're going, because you always sleep in the back thing in the morning, so we're going to the National. All of a sudden, I feel my dad just hauling ass down this dirt road into Waco, into Lake Whitney. I'm like, what the hell are you doing? He's like, this son of a bitch thinks he's going to pass me there. No fucking way. I'm eating his dust. And David is sleeping in his sleeper going, what the hell's going on? And Gary's going, this dumb son of a bitch won't let me pass. So our dads were dicing coming in. And then I always remember David, the little professor on that little bull taco, looking just like Gary and thinking, wow, how cool would it be to have a dad that rides and can teach you and do all that stuff. And so I admired him from afar, and what I found out later when we did my Lucky 13 ride, he was doing the same. He was looking at Cycle News and seeing this kid with puka shells and shit from Southern California.
Yeah, that's awesome. We're going to take a quick break, hear from our sponsors, and back for more. Guys, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, Ron Lachine.
Ron Lachine. I knew Ronnie from way back in the day. So Ronnie was a young Yamaha guy. I was a young Yamaha guy too, like 16, 17, but I think he was 2 or 3 years younger than me. And so I would take, Ronnie and I were like massive bros. Like I would take him everywhere with me because I could have a rental car. I was 17 and he was 16, or I was 18 and he was 16. Mm-hmm. So like in 83, we hung out all the time, chased down girls and, you know, just boys being boys. And then that created the problem is that he got tricked by the girl that I was dating at the time and snitched on me. It basically opened Pandora's box on what we've been doing on the road for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And so I was livid and wanted to beat his ass. And one day I was jogging down the road, him and Terry Fowler driving down the road. They pull up next to me and I'm like, hey, Ronnie. Step out of the car, you know, because I don't want to go at him because he's going to, you know, they'll run. And so he's like, no, what's going on? And he could see in my eyes, I want to whip his ass. And he goes, go, Terry, go. So they get in the car and then they haul ass. And so he called me like, what's your deal, bro? And I'm like, what's your deal? Ah, so we argued about that. And then when he went to Honda, he was so fast and I was really strong. So he was faster than me, but I was stronger than him. So I won the championship. He won Supercrosses. I won two that year. I think I won one of the great races. If you ever look it up, Gary Bailey has it. And it's a Supercross series of 1984. And you watch the Orlando. I mean, we were trying to kill each other. Mm-hmm. And I ended up winning. He got second and David got third. And we went through each other. The one time I punched him in the face at
Atlanta.
Atlanta, it was a mud race, and he looked back and brake checked me. I didn't have any brakes, and I just thought, you know, that was the straw that broke the camel's back, so I smacked him in the face. And then we had some issues with the police, and he was going to press charges, but he didn't. And but that was, I respected Ronnie for that because he was so talented. And he went down a wrong road. Mm-hmm. And but one of the things that I really respected about him was when we were racing, he got hurt, and then I got hurt. And he broke his femur. We were dicing at Steel City, and I watched him lay there with his leg all twisted and stuff. And you hate these guys, but you don't want to see that. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to see my, I want to beat him. maybe knock him down, but I don't want to hurt him or see him injured like that. And just to see him there lap after lap and the leg was sideways and all the crazy stuff. But then when I couldn't do it, because Brock came back and helped me when he retired. Mm-hmm. And so when I couldn't do it anymore, I called Ronnie and I said, dog, I said, you still could do this. And I said, I want to train you. I won't train you like everybody else wants to train you. I said, I know what you need. And he goes, RJ, he goes, I care about you too much. I just dig partying too much. I don't want to let you down. So I can't accept. Mm-hmm. And I always respected that, you know? And so even to this day, we talk on the phone, man, love you, brother. Love you too, man. And it's because we were great friends before we were fierce enemies. And mm-hmm. and that's the greatest thing that I have with both him and Wardy. You know, Wardy and I check each other before our surgeries, before my knee replacement. He's like, all right, buddy, you got this. So call me when you're out. And I call him before he goes in for his heart surgery. And so we look after each other.
Yeah. It's crazy how guys that you hated become your close friends later. Mm-hmm. Because I even asked Chicken, Jeff Matasovich, about that. Like, hey, are you and Bradshaw good now? He's like, no. Oh, no. Like, even now, right?
Yeah.
But I expected it to be like you and Wardy or you and Ronnie now.
Well, you got a redneck and you got a California dude. They are complete opposites, but you know, I race against Bradshaw now, but you realize that you couldn't be who you are without them. You know, mm-hmm. it's like Batman is not Batman without the Joker.
Yeah.
You know, and what I've learned over the years is that we always picture ourselves as Batman. But to a lot of people, I was the Joker, mm-hmm. you know, I was the bad guy. I was the guy that beat Hannah. You know, when I tried to do a victory lap with him at Unadilla, I'm riding around out of total respect. I whipped his ass 45 seconds. I demolished him. But, you know, I'm like, this is Bob Hannah and this is Unadilla and blah, blah, blah. And he's doing a victory lap. So I go behind him. I'm just like total respect, you know, just he's the king. Cause I'd already won the race, did the interview, tapped my helmet off. So I got no helmet, he's got his helmet on, and I'm cruising around, and all of a sudden, I see the crowd is, whoop, man, some dude's punched me, like, square in the face. I'm like, all right, fuck you, Nadil, I'm out of here. So I took off and hauled ass across the track. But you see what I mean?
Yeah.
They looked at it, I was being arrogant, and I wasn't willing to share the spotlight, mm-hmm. and I wasn't. But that's the guy's opinion, mm-hmm. which I knew it was. I owe him a good one. He got me square. That was hurt. That was fucking hurt.
Oh. How closely do you pay attention to racing now?
Pretty close. I mean, it's so great now with, you know, Peacock and Instagram and, mm-hmm. and all the different stuff and watching. I pay close attention. I don't know. There's certain things about it that I really don't like, and I think that they need to evolve, and they're not. Do you want to know what they are?
Yeah.
Is it the next segment or is it now?
Next segment, wait. Okay. You were the perfect spokesperson for the sport when I was this young, impressionable magazine reading guy, right? I would say it was you and then Jeremy. Mm-hmm. Jeremy was great for it.
Yeah.
What did that mean to you? And did you realize that you were doing that at the time?
Yes, because my dad would drill in me that he was hard on me, really hard on me. But it was, when you're a kid, you need that, you know. You it's not all unicorns and rainbows. But he would say, to be the best guy and to be paid more than anybody, you have to be the best and not just the rider. You gotta look good, you gotta act good, you gotta speak good, you gotta, you know, present your stuff, look good, have your stuff really, have your kit really nice. You know, he designed and painted my helmets, and so always was on the artsy side and everything looking sharp. I didn't give a shit. I'd wear a sweatshirt and an mm-hmm. open face helmet. I just wanted to ride. But he wanted me to, like, he designed that helmet, the yellow, the black, and then we put the dog on there and mm-hmm. stuff. That was another story with John Alvarez, but it was always, you have to be the best. And so I would watch interviews from Jimmy Winer. He was really outgoing and kind of crazy, and he had the pyramid and all this crazy shit. And Bob was really cocky and arrogant, and Brock was really straight-laced, and Mike Bell was ultra polite, but then just like a killer on the deal. Tony DiStefano was kind of this goofy dude from East Coast. So I just said, I want to take little pieces from everybody mm-hmm. to try to be the best.
Yeah, I think you were for sure. We're going to take another quick break. We'll be back for more. Welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, so being a great spokesperson, a great representative for motocross, you did that undeniably well. I think we can all agree that Jeremy did a great job.
Absolutely.
Too. Who do we have right now, in your opinion, that's representing us the best?
I think Jet, because we saw a chink in his armor finally. He lost his shit with Jason Anderson. Mm-hmm. He wasn't real fancy in the mud. And I think everybody down on him was good for him in the long run. As I said, I got booed. I mean, when you've come out and you're going up against Marty Smith and Brock Glover and Bob Hanna and all these guys that have been there, they don't know who you are. You're just a villain to them. And you, like, the crowd would boo me. And I could remember going, why are you booing me? You know, like, what did I do? Because it's just my job to go fast and do that. And what I think with Jet, everything has been so good. I mean, he's got the donut thing. He's cute. He rides like a son of a bitch. Mm-hmm. And he is communicating very, very well with his team. And that's where I think he's evolved better than the other guys. I think the other guys are riding fast. They're not working with their bikes as well as he is, because he took a Honda, which was supposedly the hardest bike to ride, and makes it look butter. I listened to him one day testing with Trey Kennard, and he was communicating things at 17 that I didn't until I was 22.
Mm-hmm. There's a definite talent and a skill to be able to decipher what your bike is doing and communicate that to the engineers you're working with.
Absolutely. When you come in, you need to go talk about power. You need to talk about this, talk about that. When I watched him at Anaheim, when the heat race where he got beat by Cooper Webb, I said, his bike's too high in the back. His watch is chasing him into the corner. And that's when he overshot the thing, because it was kicking too much, and he needed to get it a little lower. And they made the change. And in the main event, he was a different guy. And that's when he annihilated everybody. I also, you got to love Aaron Plessinger. You know, he's just such a great guy. And what I like is that it's not a fluke that he won, and he's fast every weekend. He's getting quicker, and he's right there. Mm-hmm. You know, I think everybody has a couple holes in their game, and they can work on that. But he's, as far as the crowd, God, everyone loves him. You know, I had him on when I was doing the Toyota Escondido show. Mm-hmm. Some bitch sang a cappella just right, boom, just right off the bat. And I'm like, that's awesome that he has that kind of balls, and he cares that much. And so I think those two are the guys right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, earlier in the last segment, we talked about your heroes and stuff. But I cut you off because you were starting to say there's things in the sport right now that are shortcomings. So what are those things?
We have to have racing. If it's not a race, all right, the biggest star, what is the biggest star of a Supercross, real quick?
The winner, usually, right?
The track.
Oh, okay.
Always. All right. And so when I see, I was developing truck tracks and how to design them and try to create passing, make the outside line the fastest way, but the inside the shorter way. You don't increase torpedoing people, you increase, you know, passing. Mm-hmm. You narrow up the entries so that you limit, so that nobody can get this, you know. You narrow up the entry and widen up the exit. So if you come in mid-corner, I come high, it gives me room to come underneath you. Mm-hmm. It's not the same in, the same out. That's one. The other thing is that we got to get rid of hole shot devices. Why do we have them? They're going fucking 70 miles an hour into the corner.
Yeah.
Seriously, you go take a 450, go out here, pin it second gear, don't shift the thing, you're going 70. Mm-hmm. All right? And everyone's doing that, and everyone's coming up. I think the steel grate is good because that keeps it consistent. Mm-hmm. Get rid of those so we have more mistakes coming off the gate, and we'll get some separation. It's just everybody's coming in there with mapping and throttle control and all the different shit. Guys are pinning it, mm-hmm, and dropping the clutch. So it's just a matter of timing.
Yeah,
it's like a drag race. Before you had to, you know, I had to pull modulate gears and do all, mm-hmm, the different stuff. Completely different.
You know, wait, real quick. You know what's funny about that? Mary, during the middle of COVID, Ryan Villopoto promoted that MX Bike Club in Ohio. Mm-hmm. So it was just this motley crew of racers, yeah, like Travis Pastrana, Michael S., RV.
Rob Bidas invited me, and I said, there's no way I'm going.
Yeah. But they were like, Wyndham was like, hole shot device, I don't have one of those, I've never used one, right?
Right.
So they were gonna say, no start devices. Alessi was freaking out. He'd never done a start without one.
Right, and I'm not saying, okay, today we're doing it, but just tell everybody, throw them in the trash.
Yeah.
For next year. We gotta get some separation. We're seeing big injuries, big crashes, because everyone's coming in, and it's always in the main event. Mm-hmm. You know, in the heat race, I've argued with AMA about they need to widen up the first turn for the main event. Well, it worked for the heat. Well, that's bullshit, because there's only four guys in this heat that want the hole shot. Everybody else is like, well, fuck it. I made the mm-hmm night show. I'm just cruising. But in the main event, everybody wants, 20 guys are going for the hole shot.
Yeah.
And so then they're going to, and those guys are like, well, if I made it here, if I could just get out front, I got a good chance. So you have to do something there. The other thing that I would like to see is, we did it in truck racing, is a competition yellow. Go half the race, stop the race, stack them up. Mm. Then separate the gate. I think the problem that they have right now is when they do that, for one, this is bullshit. If they go around one lap, then you shouldn't have to redo a start. Because it's so sketchy, mm-hmm, you know? And so a guy gets a good start, he's leading, next thing you know, he's doesn't make the fucking main because he got screwed on the second time around. Mm-hmm. So it should be, if they complete one lap and they throw a red, that they need to line them up the way they're doing.
Yeah.
The mistake that they're making is that they put the back to pass on the line going into the corner. You do it around the corner and you say you cannot breach the guy. The whole idea is just to bring us back together, but not that. Mm-hmm. So if you do go down on the first turn, or we do get a Jet Lawrence or somebody that goes down the first turn, they make their way back up to fifth. Now I can see who's leading. I can see, mm-hmm, Eli Tomac or whoever it might be, Cooper Webb, Aaron Plessner, whoever it is. And that gives a chance to have a great race to the end of the race. Mm-hmm. And they're like, well, that's, you know, no, but I can see when someone's out in front crushing everybody like Jet Lawrence was, how many people are bored and leave.
Yeah.
Then you go to a mud race where it's like, who knows what's going to happen, and everybody's staying there. We're in the entertainment business first. We're in the racing business second. Mm-hmm. And so if it's not entertaining, people aren't going to watch it. And so you need to make sure that you create ways of passing. It's not just torpedoing on the inside. I think they need to speed the tracks up a little bit, get rid of hole shot devices, and bring in a competition yellow. I think that would bring everybody back together, and you'd have one hell of a race, especially as deep as the field is now.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
You know,
crazy.
If you start 10th and you work your way up to fifth, you're doing great. Now you've brought the guy from half a lap lead back into your range.
Yeah. All right. Through the years, you've worked with riders after you retired. Who is the most talented and who is the hardest to work with?
The hardest to work with was Ricky Carmichael, because his camp didn't want me to.
Mm-hmm.
And I still argue this with Jeannie and Ricky. They said that Ricky was at Tampa Supercross when he was a little kid, stood there the whole day while I was there, and right before I was going to leave, he came up, and all he wanted to say was, hey, my name's Ricky too. and supposedly this is what they say, I disagree, I'm done. I'm busy. Mm-hmm. I don't think I would ever do that, but they carried that grudge with me for a long time. You know, for a long time. Like, it was literally after Ricky won the championships with Suzuki, and Ricky goes, "Mom, tell him the truth," you know? And they told me that. I'm like, if I did, I apologize, but I don't think I would have ever done that. Anyhow, the reason Ricky was tough is because he was on top of the world. Yeah. And he did everything right. And I helped Ricky with two things. That was it. One was James Stewart beat him really bad at Anaheim. Mm-hmm. Because Ricky was using his technique that he beat Jeremy McGrath with, coming in straight, squaring the corner, and taking off, which worked good with the 250s, but it doesn't work as good on the 450s. James was using more of the corners, rounding the corner, keeping it going. So I was walking over to do a press thing, and Ricky was there, and I'm like, I know I'm not supposed to be working with you, but just trust me on this. So we walked into a corner, and let's hypothetically say 19 is there. So we're walking, I go, what are you pointing at? He's going on the inside, and it was the left-hand corner. 19. We get to a little bit. And I go, what are you pointing at? 19. I go, I'm at 16. What are you pointing at? I'm at 19. I said, I'm at 12. All right. And mm-hmm. now we're meeting in the same place in the corner. You haven't started your direction change, and James is getting back on the gas. You got to open this thing up and keep these things going. And mm-hmm. and he just like, okay, that's it. And then when he was the last race, we was going the championship with James against James and Chad Reed. Ricky, there's nobody in the history of the sport ever pulled the trigger as hard as him. Mm-hmm. Never. And he would go so fast to the bumps, but he would lose it and he would crash. And I would say, so I just said, it was really slick and hard in Vegas. I said, Ricky, just come off the gas a little bit. Don't take the little bog that as you're going slower. Take that as you're getting traction. Cause if it's just going bop, 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 it's just deflecting. Mm-hmm. So just come off it just a little bit and you'll feel it accelerate through the bumps. And that, I think that was one of the best races I've ever seen, including, there wasn't the passing going back and forth, but these guys were within a tenth and a half.
Yeah.
The whole race, all three of them. Mm-hmm. Like Jeremy McGrath and I were sitting there watching, just going, this is fucking unreal. How good these guys are and how none of them, you know, they would go back and forth 1/10. All 20 laps, and it was phenomenal. Easiest to work with was, in some ways, Sebastian Tortelli. I could tell him to run into a wall, he would do it. Very, very, same thing with Jeff Stanton.
Are you the one that told him to practice starts in his driveway?
No.
To learn concrete?
No, I didn't tell him that, but but both Jeff and Sebastian were, what you tell me what to do, I'll do it. And that's the way Jeff was when he came and worked with me, you know, in the beginning of, I think it was 98. Mm-hmm. Or, yeah, in 89, sorry.
Yeah. Man, RJ, we're out of time, but I'm stoked to learn that you live not too far from here.
It's right up the hill.
Like, yeah, we're gonna have to go get lunch or grab beer or maybe adventure ride or something, but it's still a thrill for me. I feel like little impressionable motocross action reading Donn sitting with RJ.
Well, I'm stoked to be here. It's great to see what you and how the sport has evolved between social media, between podcasts, between all this stuff. We didn't have any of it. Mm-hmm. We had Cycle News. We had Cycle News, then a month later we had Motocross Action, Dirt Bike, Dirt Rider, and
Super Motocross.
Know. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we didn't even have Trans World back then.
Yeah. What's that? Magazine. Thank you for coming on.
My pleasure, brother.
All right, guys. Thanks for checking out the SML show. Please like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.